please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
Welcome back. Well, a lot of stocks are surging now. Just see some of the intraday charts. Let's start with Sun TV. That stock has moved to the high point. Shriram Transport Finance has also moved to the high point. But really, the stock of the moment for me is United Spirits. Just see the intraday chart on that stock. It's just, I mean, just taken off from at 3 p.m. 3370 to 3415, just in 5 minutes. It's a big move that you're seeing right now. For Ashwani Gujral and Mitesh Thakkar with us for BTST Calls, buy today, sell tomorrow. Ashwani, your thoughts first on index. You've said that perhaps we are at the higher end, so may not make too much sense to buy, but what about individual stocks?
See, IndusInd Bank is probably the top gainer in the bank Nifty, so some fresh breakout here. That's a buy with a stop of 1940, target of 1975. NBCC is a buy with a stop of 87, target of 95. And Reliance Capital is a buy with a stop of 417, target of 440.
Okay, that's an interesting one within the NBFC pack. Reliance Capital is something that Ashwani is going with. Mitesh, what about you?
Two BTST calls. One is Larsen & Toubro, buy with a BTST with a stop at 1354 for targets of 1380.85. And Jindal Steel & Power, I think that's also showing good traction on the half-hourly chart. So BTST, buy with a stop at 242 and look for a 255 kind of target.
Okay, fair enough. Anand, you know, your thoughts on a stock like Ashok Leyland, which there was some concern about the, you know, heavy loading norms, etc. That one, and in general, your top pick in auto at this point in time.
Well, auto, I think, you know, Leyland, Mahindra, Bajaj, I think are all in a very sweet spot right now. Valuations notwithstanding, well, Ashok Leyland a little expensive, but you know, as you mentioned, with many states now acting quite strict on the overloading, plus the fact that there will be a change in the fuel norms, etc., and perhaps some scrapping rules coming through, I think the next couple of years looks quite good for the four wheelers. And you know, therefore, I don't see that any state, any major weakening happening in this sector. We've already mentioned M&M, and I think Bajaj now is starting to kick in with their export numbers picking up. So I think all the three of them are looking quite good.
Fair enough, Anand. Thanks a lot for your time today. It was good talking to you. Well, the PSU rally is continuing. The latest to join the bandwagon is BHEL. Just see the intraday chart on BHEL, and that stock right now making a move. NBCC also right now making a move to the high point of the day. Concor, that one also seeing a move. So see the intraday chart on Concor as well. That one also moving to the high point of the day. We just spoke about United Spirits. United Breweries is also making a move towards the high point. So a lot of these names. Cement is reversing. Intraday, if you see some of the names like Ambuja Cement, there's a bit of a reversal that you are seeing. Interesting that the Nifty is still not able to take out 10,850, still at around 10,836. But let's get in some more market opinion. Earlier, we spoke to Madhu Kela, the market veteran, and we asked him first his thoughts on the pharma space where we're seeing the big rally.
Certainly more than short covering in my perspective, because you see the kind of wealth distraction which has happened in this sector. You know, in 2008, we were at 1 lakh crore. Then we went to 10 lakh crores, and that 10 lakh crores became half. And to best of my understanding, you know, none of these companies have ever declared a loss, including companies like Wockhardt, which has passed through difficult circumstances. They're still investing so heavily, 13-14% of their sales into R&D. So a lot of these companies have been spending a lot of money in the R&D. So what happened in the pharma sector was a combination of two factors. One, you had a huge FDA issues across all companies, large cap and as well as in mid caps. And also there were a lot of, you know, froth which was there in terms of valuation. I think both of them are correcting now.
What about something like Divi's Labs? I mean, it went through a really rough patch and then it sort of recovered so much in the last 6-8 months. Do you see any kind of potential there?
Yeah, I think that company has demonstrated clearly, you know, a lot of people in the market were a little skeptical, their data integrity, this, that. I've always maintained, we've been a very long investor there. I personally have investments, so I must clarify that. So I think they have demonstrated this, at least this is the first time maybe, maybe in the world, that some company got a US FDA problem and that to a warning letter and an inspection, and they got it cleared in 7-8 months. Yes. So I think that speaks volume about their capability and what the management is all about. So I think they are in a really good phase right now, and you see, I hope they make additional capex because they've always been very careful on committing capex.
What's the sense you're getting this year? Because once again, you know, we are discussing what happens to next election, politics as a factor. This year, we have been the worst performing emerging market. Mid caps are seeing quite a bit of pain after a good 2017. Your thoughts?
So if we break the market, Anuj, broadly in two categories. So let's talk first about the index. You know, I find it very, very hard to emphasize the index falling like more than 10%. And I have done all kinds of permutation combination, what will lead to fall, how much, what kind of earnings will, because there is significant weightage in the index of stalwarts like HDFC Bank, Kotak Mahindra Bank. You have IT companies which have a huge weightage on the index. And you have a lot of these FMCG companies, which are more secular in terms of. So for me to emphasize that an index can fall a lot, that doesn't look like a big probability. Now, you will really, really need some big jolt from the world or from India, something which is completely unexpected, for the index to fall big time. And that is what has got demonstrated, that, you know, we get a jerk, but it doesn't sustain at a lower level because these defensives and the good companies have a lot of weightage on Nifty, you know. So, and the mid-cap, you know, let's just come to, obviously, you know, all of us were feeling that there is, there is a euphoria in the mid-cap side, specifically micro companies, you know. I was being told there are some 200 portfolio managers between Churchgate and Borivali now. So everyone had got money and everyone was investing that, you know. And obviously a lot of people who are first timers who have not seen market cycles. Yeah. So what we saw in the last 2-3 weeks, you know, a complete massacre. And we track some of these companies closely. So I was just seeing a list of companies which have lost like more than 40%. There were some 150, 200 names of market cap erosion of between 40 to 80%. So some of it has got corrected. You know, but what I'm saying in the mid-cap side, specifically when the large companies are available at attractive valuation, you have to be really sure about two things. A, about the quality of management, and B, about the earning predictability. Because market is completely unforgiving on these two counts.
I wish I could just simply ask you, what's the next Bajaj Finance? But on NBFCs, because it's a wide universe, housing finance, consumer finance, even some of the rural and SME finance plays. We were just talking to M&M Financial Services yesterday. The companies sound very bullish, but which spectrum, what kind of businesses are you most optimistic on?
That's why again I'm saying it's a portfolio approach. So you buy maybe one or two public sector banks, you buy one or two private sector banks, and maybe you buy one or two NBFC names, because you can't have all your portfolio. But I'm saying on the back of this IBC resolution, and personally, I'm very, very bullish on our new finance minister. I'm a big fan of his. Mm-hmm. And, you know, he's already shown in the last 2 weeks that, you know, he's already called meetings, he's already in the path of resolution. And the kind of work which he did in the power ministry, the kind of work which he did when he was a coal minister, and again when he came to railway, I think I am very sure that government is also taking a note of these problems, and you will see a significant resolution even coming from the government side.
Welcome back. Steady as she goes. That's the Nifty for you. Not just the Nifty, it's a good day for the mid-cap market as well. The Nifty has had its little bit of moments of jitters here and there, but otherwise rally intact. And that's the index that's seeing plenty of buying in individual stocks. So Anuj, as we were discussing at the start, today is not a repeat of yesterday.
Yes.
Does this look like some conviction coming back?
Yeah, you know, but if we close here, it will be the highest closing it will be higher than the reversal day. Remember the reversal day when the market went to 10,930, the Karnataka
election result
outcome, and the market closed that day at 10,806. After that, you haven't had a closing above that mark, Surabhi. The market's gone above that intraday two or three times. It's not done that. Mm. Technically, if we close here, after a long time, we would have made a higher high. So, the market's been making higher lows, but this would be the first higher high for the market. And I think that really would be interesting, because that would mean that even those who would have taken shorts since that day, they would be now, thinking that, whether this market has reversed. And this mid-cap action is telling you that a lot of this is not just short covering. There's quite a bit of buying. I don't know. I just want to point out one thing. Just keep an eye on the delivery stats of State Bank of India. I think today there's been some really heavy-duty buying in State Bank of India. If you see the intraday chart, and if you see the volume chart of State Bank of India, it won't surprise me to see some, say, 400, 500 crores kind of buying in SBI today. It's been that kind of day. So, some of these big index stocks have made a big move today.
Oh, absolutely. No denying that. Look at that. It's still up and away, and we've still got over 10 minutes of trade left. Contrast today's picture, our picture, with what's happening in some of the European markets, and we're rank outperformers today. Actually, it doesn't matter. This is an intrinsic rally that's just building on. European markets are fairly lackluster at this point in time. So on that note, let's also bring in Nimesh and get a sense of what the action is like out there. Nimesh, what have people been saying? There's, plenty of steady green today on the screen.
Oh, yes, sir. So markets are at day's high. And in fact, that's been the trend for the last few days. But I guess, the one feedback that I'm constantly getting off late is the market is quite light from a positioning point of view. If I talk to a lot of, retail HNI desk, and the feedback is that a lot of the HNI retail investors got wiped out in the recent correction. So there is not much in terms of, big positions either in the cash market or in the futures market from the retail end. And that probably means that, the markets are quite light. And that explains the kind of rally you're seeing in the mid-cap and small-cap as well. Clear sector winner for the last few days is pharma. I'm told that there's good institutional buying coming into the pharma names now at these levels. And maybe, in the next 1 week, 10 days, you'll probably see an NFO of, in that healthcare space coming very soon. So maybe now, even the mutual fund industry feels that at these levels, there is some sectoral, bet to be made in the pharma names from here on. So that probably explains the kind of move you've seen in the pharma names in the past few days. Banking is another sector where you've seen some bit of buying coming back. There is some large amount of institutional buying coming into the PSU bank name as well of late. So that's the other sector to watch out. But broadly, the sense I'm getting is, the institutional activity is quite intact. Because of the light positioning by the retail and HNI category, that probably explains the kind of move you're seeing in the mid-cap and small-cap stocks after the recent correction.
Okay, Nimesh, thanks a lot for that. Talking about PSU bank move, perhaps good time to get in a word from Uday Kotak of Kotak Mahindra Bank. In fact, here's Ritu Singh in conversation with Uday.
So you didn't specifically say whether or not bad bank is a good idea or a bad idea. And as far as you're saying, it's an out-of-the-box thinking. It has been proposed before several government...
I think I would wait for how the committee, which has been formed, which is to be looking at it over the next 2 weeks, what shape and form the committee recommends. That's when you have a better perspective of what the contours of that are.
Kotak, your bank itself, you had raised funds and you said you're interested in stressed asset opportunities. So your views on a national ARC or something like that,
We are continuing to invest in a number of opportunities.
Yeah.
So if the investment opportunity makes sense on a risk-return basis, we are always open to looking at opportunity.
But, given that these are weak public sector banks, do you think time is now ripe for consolidation? Instead of looking at, ad hoc solutions like selling their bad assets portfolios?
At this point of time, 1 year before election, it's the wrong time to be thinking about consolidation of public sector banks in any shape at this point of time.
But when do you think, do you think there is a scope or there's reason enough for so many banks to exist when a lot of them are doing the same work and are not in a good position? The government is also not able to capitalize all of them to the extent needed.
Right time you have to think about these things. Okay.
So, you also spoke about the public-private bank structure. You said, 70% market share of the public sector banks, 30% private sector banks. That could change in the next few years. Do you still maintain that view?
I think we are seeing the share change in terms of loans, and that is a process which really depends on how the growth happens. But I think right now, microeconomy is doing very well. Credit demand is good, and it doesn't matter whether you are public or private. If you have the capacity to support growth of the economy, we should be doing it, and we are really happy to be supporting the growth of Indian economy. And whatever the share is an outcome of that.
sir, you know, you've been a big champion of the IBC, but you know, are you as a banker really satisfied with what we've seen so far? I know you said the government has been quick to respond with changes, but some of those changes, especially the Section 29A, has been the cause for a lot of these delays.
I think you have to. Some of the first successes are good. The process is evolving. Some of it is taking a little longer. In many cases, 270 days period is getting over. Yeah. So we have to watch the process. And I think this is a process of evolution. Mm. The most important point about IBC is it has decisively changed the balance in favor of the creditor in control versus the debtor in control. And I think that's a very powerful move.
But sure, sir, you know, while there are haircuts for the bankers, that's one thing to be considered. But the minority shareholders, I mean, they have a left, you know, they left a literally.
An equity owner's right to claim is after the debt owner.
Okay.
So that is first principles of corporate finance.
All right, sir. Thank you very much.
Okay, you know, I tell you something, it's always fascinating to hear. Uday Kotak, always candid, and I think the two points that he made, one is that in an election year, perhaps, you know, it will be a bit foolish to expect, you know, large-scale consolidation as far as the PSU banks are concerned. And second, of course, it was on the IBC case is the point that he made. But anyway, Sanjeev Bhasin of IIFL joins us now, and as we speak, the Bank Nifty is at the high point of the day. Sanjeev, hi, good afternoon. Your thoughts first on SBI, in fact, the entire PSU gamut, and the kind of buying that we're seeing right now.
Well, it's left all the, you know, all the naysayers on the sideline, people who had thought of 220 and below. From the time of the results, I think the SBI chairman has been most confident that I've seen him in a lot of time. And extremely bullish on the long term. Plus, you heard what the language of the management was, 50,000 crore stress assets or write backs in the next 6 to 9 months. And I think no reason that State Bank shouldn't be trading at a, you know, decent premium to what it was. So State Bank, Indian Bank, Bank of Baroda, these have been three of our very, very strong picks. We put our neck out when there was no, you know, when there was a lot of chaos. But all three have delivered handsome returns, and we still think that PSU banks could lead the charge going forward if the Nifty has to go, if the Nifty and the Bank Nifty have to go to new highs.
Okay, Sanjeev, the other fascinating aspect of trade last 2 days has been this relentless buying in pharma stocks. What would you back, if any, at the moment?
Well, we've always had a contrarian play on the back that most of the bad news was in the price, and the results this time belied most naysayers again, because the local business has shown a lot of traction. So Sun, Dr. Reddy, Aurobindo, Lupin, Biocon, these five are our premier picks, and we still think there's a 25% upside. There are three things for them. One, they become a good proxy to a weak rupee. Two, the FDAs now mean that most of the complexities on the farming, on the contract farming, those have become, you know, been put behind. And three, the new launches which they have are, I think, the strongest I've seen in the last 18 quarters. So on any decline, add all five of them, I think they can be very, very good proxies. And they will regain their defense nature, you know, they will not fall even if the market corrects sharply from here.
Okay, Sanjeev, I'll come back to you, but let me just take some final thoughts from Ashwani as well. Ashwani, we're closing about 10,850 or near about. Does that change things for the Nifty?
See, basically, yesterday we closed at the lows, today we closed at the highs. Mm-hmm. I mean, this is a perfect way of trying to trap long positions by showing them, you know, we've broken out by 10 points. I think we need a decisive close, you know, beyond, say, 10,900, so that you can assume that there will be follow-through. You know, these sort of rallies and declines, this sort of action happens in, you know, ranging markets. So if you made money today, went long in the morning, etc., let's wait for tomorrow and see if we are able to clear it finally.
Fair point. Sanjeev, from your point of view, you think the market is now on course for hitting new all-time high, 11,100?
Well, I think there will be a little bit of plateauing, but 11,000 and 11,300 is where we are looking at in the month of June itself. And I think mid-caps can be rank outperformers. So you've seen that in the last 3 days, and you know the pessimism itself will take you beyond 11,000. Because there are enough people on the sideline who are watching a, you know, dead cat bounce, or you may call it whatever. and markets are not willing to give you an inch on the downside. So I am relatively more sanguine for the next 3 months. I think new highs are maybe on the cards on the Nifty, but it will be all about stock specific. So you know, if I could say a stock, a sale was 68 about 3 weeks back, it's hit 90 rupees. So it's telling you the outperformance of select mid-caps can be huge, which you will see maybe in the second half of June and July.
Well, we've got just about 2 minutes to go to wrap up what has been quite a fantastic day in favor of the bulls. By the way, the mid-cap index was within kissing distance of 19,000, a whole 1% rally on that index as well. And for the Nifty itself, it's going to be a close above 10,850, Anuj. So, I mean, I guess so far so good, the way things have turned around last three, four sessions.
For sure. And, you know, Lupin, Dr. Reddy's, both ending at the high point. Along with SBI, and these are the three stocks where you had the highest volumes also today. And then, as I said, you keep an eye on the delivery stats of stocks like SBI, Dr. Reddy's, and Lupin. There's just some serious buying which is taking place. I think this really is the value buying. You know, we're talking about the hunt for value.
Yeah.
This I think really is the hunt for value which is played out in some of these names. Hindustan Unilever, of course, keeps hitting new highs. So that one also up about 2.5%. IndusInd Bank up 2.5%. Big move in TCS, 2% higher. Reliance was up about 2%. Larsen & Toubro, Sun Pharma. So across the board buying is what we had. On the way down, yesterday's big gainer, Bharti Airtel, corrected today. So 2% down on that. Tata Steel was a bit soft, down about 1.5% on Tata Steel. And Coal India, Hindalco, a couple of other losers. But overall, really strong day for the bulls today, Sarbi.
Absolutely. And on the mid-cap side of the market, it's a strong market. And you won't see me talk about too many PC Jeweler, Vakrangi, Manpasand kind of stocks. It wasn't about them today. It was about leadership coming in from very different quarters. Mid-cap IT and mid-cap pharma roaring away both of these sectors. So on the pharma side, I'll just take some names. Divi's is managed about a 3.5-4% sort of an up move. Strides Shasun, of course, that product approval surely helped. That stock was in positive territory throughout the day, almost 5% higher. Granules, Glenmark Pharma, so a lot of these stocks beyond the Nifty 50 have also had a phenomenal session today on the pharma side. On mid-cap tech, let's start off with KPIT Tech. That stock had a nice run towards the afternoon. NIIT Tech obviously keeping it good company as well. Tata Elxsi, a lot of these names were on the upside. First Source about 2-3% up as well. So all of these stocks anywhere close to their 52-week highs and piling on some more momentum today as well. Then there was this mega PSU rally. Now we don't know if mega PSU rally. Now we don't know if it stays or fizzles out, whether it was a one-day wonder. But the numbers are phenomenal. 13% on MMTC, for instance. You have big moves on a Shipping Corporation of India, 8.5% higher. EIL was surging almost 3-4% up there. Even a BEML managed about a 1% up move by the end of it, Dredging Corporation. So, you know, across the board, there was a lot of traction on this side of the market. And then other stocks stood out as well. Lemon Tree, 7% on the upside. You had some buying on the likes of HDFC Standard Life as well, 3-3.5% up on that stock. Ashok Leyland undid some of the declines of yesterday. Positive close on Leyland, about 1.5% on the upside. USL, UB, Just Dial. Take a look at a Quest Corp, for instance. If you're talking about interesting traction in the market today, 7% up on Quest Corp. Jyoti Laboratories, it was a stock that was discussed during the Sohn conference, 6% up on Jyoti today as well. Purvankar, I could just go on and on. It's a big list of gainers. Sequence Scientific, 7% on the upside. So a lot of stocks finding traction today. On the downside, not much to complain, really. Yeah, so you did have the likes of a Manpasand Beverage losing ground. Marico lost 2.5%. Jet Airways was down. And on Syntex, I beg your pardon, on Inox Wind, the pressure is still on, despite the fact that new auditor names have been now announced. But that was, again, a stock that was under pressure. Overall, a great session for the mid-cap market as well today, Anuj.
Oh, phenomenal, Surabhi. And, really interesting the way some of these stocks have bounced back. Of course, pharma names in particular, but others as well. There's been some real strong buying that you've seen in some of these names. Let's take final thoughts then, Mitesh. Your verdict for the day then?
So Anuj, I think I've been seeing some kind of positive bias on the Nifty. I think we are ready to, we've already started that movement, I think, you know, closing beyond the 10,825 mark. I think 10,930 and then 11,000 could be the next two targets which I would look on the upside. The key here would be Bank Nifty. If the Bank Nifty also starts getting past 26,700-750 zone, then I think a test of around 27,250 could happen, and the Bank Nifty could also enjoy significant momentum. But otherwise, it still remains a market which, to me, while choppy, appears to be clearly positively biased.
Okay. Ashwani, almost 1,000 again on Reliance. 1,011 has been the all-time high.
I think there are some stocks which will continue to rally whatever the market does. But, you know, extrapolation is a dangerous game in this sort of environment. And now, you know, this 10,900, 11,000 is that place where everybody gets bullish and you get into some kind of trouble. So Reliance is at the top end of its range. I think we need to successfully trade above this zone. The rally from 900, almost 100 bucks in about 7-8 days. So let's see if we can consolidate here and then move higher. If we just simply get past 1,000, then, you know, possibly the market will come off. So I need to see 1,000 cross with some sort of decisive action.
Okay. Finally, Sanjeev, since you are optimistic on this market and you think that it's going to surprise people who are sitting on the sidelines, what's the advice to them? Maybe one or two stock ideas you can leave us with today?
Yeah, so I'll give you three names in the large caps and three in the short, so in the mid caps. So Reliance, ITC and Bajaj Auto in the large caps. We still think that Reliance is going to be heading into the $100 billion club, and maybe this month itself, 1,050. And in the mid caps, we are extremely bullish on NBCC, Power Finance and Capital First. We think these three stocks could see a lot of re-rating after the quarterly results as fundamentals are improving on a day-to-day basis.
Okay. All right. Sanjeev, Ashwani and Mitesh, thanks very much for joining in and taking us through market close. Solid Tuesday going to the bulls today. On that note, we'll take a quick break. On the other side, U.S. President Donald Trump and North Korea's Kim Jong-un concluded their extraordinary nuclear summit. History in the making over there. We'll get you all the highlights.
Going to take care of a very big and very dangerous problem for the world.
Welcome back. President Donald Trump and North Korea's Kim Jong-un concluded an extraordinary summit in Singapore today, with promises being made by the American president to take care of a very dangerous problem, and Kim forecasting major change for the world. The document signed by Trump and Kim Jong-un includes following four main elements relating to the peace regime. CNBC's Martin Sung joins in with more details.
So a historic day for Donald Trump, the U.S. president, the first sitting American president to meet with a North Korean leader. The summit here in Singapore started at 9 o'clock sharp. Both men strode on stage facing each other, shook hands, turned towards the camera for that photo op. And this is literally the photo op of the century, an image that is likely to be talked about for days, if not weeks, to come. Then they went inside and started fairly intensive negotiations and discussions for the rest of the afternoon, and came out again and sat at a table and signed a joint document. The key points of that document, three things. One, a commitment to denuclearization. Also, commitment to further dialogue. And finally, a commitment to peace here. Now, specifically, what they were talking about is committing both sides to working together towards achieving the goal of full denuclearization of the Korean Peninsula. Equally so, with regard to a dialogue and establishing normal relations, and also to do with establishing peace between the two sides. I have to say, though, that there was a conspicuous lack of detail to the document. No specifics in terms of, especially with regard to denuclearization, the where, the how, and the why, although post the conclusion of the summit at a press conference, at a Q&A session with reporters, and pushed on this issue, the president said, yes, there will be verification of denuclearization on the part of North Korea, and there would be international inspectors and experts involved, American ones, as well as from the rest of the world. So that was at least positive. He also said that Secretary of State Mike Pompeo, right after the conclusion of the summit, was already hard at work working out the details of implementation and execution, suggesting that this is going to be a long-drawn process. President Moon Jae-in of South Korea has talked about denuclearization, complete and full denuclearization, being taking as much as 2 years. But it is a beginning today, and it is the first for an American president in meeting a North Korean leader. But again, it's going to come down to the results.
Now let's also hear out what President Trump had to say on this historic meeting with the North Korean leader and the agreement that they have reached for complete denuclearization of North Korea.
I want to thank Chairman Kim for taking the first bold step toward a bright new future for his people. Our unprecedented meeting, the first between an American president and a leader of North Korea, proves that real change is indeed possible. Chairman Kim and I just signed a joint statement in which he reaffirmed his unwavering commitment to complete denuclearization of the Korean Peninsula. We also agreed to vigorous negotiations to implement the agreement as soon as possible. We will be stopping the war games, which will save us a tremendous amount of money, unless and until we see that the future negotiation is not going along like it should. But we'll be saving a tremendous amount of money. We talk about unwavering commitment to the complete denuclearization of the Korean Peninsula. This is the document that we just signed.
All right, on that note, let's take a quick break. On the other side, M&M's market share in utility vehicles has hit a new low. We'll get you all the details and the numbers. Welcome back. M&M's market share in utility vehicles has continued to be on a declining slope. In fact, it has touched the lowest ever mark in May. We have Utkarsh Chaturvedi joining in with some analysis. Utkarsh, how are the numbers looking?
Surbhi, exactly as you said, this month, last month, if you look at the time numbers, the market share is at 23.5%, which is the lowest ever M&M ever had. In fact, if you look at the last financial year as well, M&M ended as a number two player, after Maruti. Before this, M&M was the leader in the SUV market for a long time. But last year, after the introduction of the Vitara, Brezza and the Ertiga, both of these vehicles really doing well. A lot of market share was hit of M&M, and that is why they ended up in the second position. Last month as well, they were trying to really close the gap. In fact, if you look at the whole year also, January, February, March, M&M somehow managed to retain market share there and be the number one player. But again, in April and May, if you look at the data, the numbers have gone down. In fact, with the Tata Nexon really doing well, Tata Motors has done pretty well when it comes to the UV market share. Their UV market share in the month of May stands at around 7.2%. Maruti, on the other side, at this point of time, is a 31% market share. And Jeep Compass also has had a hit on the M&M's market share because, you know, it competes with the XUV500. They have a market share of around 2%. So clearly, Mahindra has to work out on a new strategy. But what will be interesting is this festive season, because Maruti and Mahindra rivalry, at least at this point of time, to be the number one in the UV space will continue. M&M will launch 3 new products, remember. All of them SUVs, but Maruti will be coming out with a new Ertiga. Remember, Ertiga has been a very successful product. And all the 3 products which M&M will be launching will not be of the range of Ertiga. So the numbers which we can expect is of Ertiga will be higher. But as I said, it will be interesting to watch this rivalry going ahead of getting the number one position in the UV market.
All right. Thanks, Utkarsh, so much for getting us that update there. Moving on now, Tata Steel is likely to bag Bhushan Power. Ritu Singh is joining in with details on this resolution. Ritu, what's the latest?
After Bhushan Steel, it looks like Tata Steel is set to bag Bhushan Power in the second go. We do remember, even in the first round between JSW Steel and Tata Steel was declared the highest bidder, but then Liberty House submitted a bid after the deadline, which the NCLT ordered the COC to consider. So yesterday's meeting took into consideration all of the bids and has again come to the conclusion that Tata Steel is the preferred bidder, even though Liberty House has placed a higher bid. We understand that Liberty's offer stands at about 26,000 crore rupees, in which 18,500 crore rupees is the repayment to lenders, whereas Tata's offer stands at 24,000 odd crore rupees, in which 16,600 crore rupees is what they've offered to repay the lenders. But given that there was no clarity on the source of funds for Liberty House, the lenders are not really comfortable with their higher offer and have instead chosen to go with Tata Steel. 19th of June is the next committee of creditors meeting to watch out for. PwC, in the meanwhile, will be implementing the eligibility test on all of these players under Section 29A.
All right, Ritu, thanks for that. But you also can perhaps tell us something about what's happening with Ruchi Soya. Sources saying that the Committee of Creditors will open revised bids, and bids are coming in from both Patanjali and Adani.
Both the bids submitted by Patanjali Group and Adani Wilmar will be considered by the COC today. That is, the bids will be opened. Both of these bids were submitted yesterday, but do remember, even before that, in the first round of bidding, Patanjali was the highest bidder at 4,000 crore rupees, followed by Adani Wilmar at 3,285 crore rupees, after which both of the players again had offered to revise their bids to 5,800 crore rupees for Patanjali and about 6,000 crore rupees for Adani Wilmar. But those bids were not accepted by the COC, that has instead chosen to go for an inter-se bidding under the Swiss auction method, which means first an H1 will be declared, then H2, that is the second highest bidder, will be allowed to match that bid. And if they do match the highest bid, H1 will again be given a chance to counter that bid. So that process will be on, and it will be an intense bidding to maximize value between Patanjali Group as well as Adani Wilmar. Do remember, Ruchi Soya has a debt of over 12,000 crore rupees.
All right, thanks, Ritu, very much for getting us details on both of those cases. Quick break right now. On the other side, commodity bets coming up with Prathamesh Malia of Angel Commodities. Welcome back. An important story that we need to track right now. The RBI governor was presenting himself before the parliamentary committee today, and sources are indicating that he's told the parliamentary standing committee that RBI doesn't have enough powers to control PSU banks and that perhaps certain legislative amendments might be required to give RBI absolute control. Let's understand this better. My colleague Rituparna Bhuyan is joining in with all the details. Very important statements there, Ritu. Tell us more.
Well, this actually came in the form of a written statement by the RBI governor to the parliamentary panel, where he has said that the Banking Regulation Act, because of the clauses in the Banking Regulation Act, public sector banks are essentially corporations set up by statute and not essentially companies. So this is the basic reason why RBI can't fully control the public sector banks. Not only that, he has given 9 specific cases which are applicable to private banks but not to public sector banks. For example, RBI governor has told the parliamentary panel in a written submission that it does not have powers to appoint or remove CMDs, CEO, and chairman and senior managerial staff. It has also doesn't have the power of licensing and licensing related conditions. So nine such conditions have been specified. He goes on to say in his submission that a dialogue regarding the Section 51 of the Banking Regulation Act is on with the government, and that RBI would, seek amendments of the Section 51 of the Banking Regulation Act so that it can regulate public sector banks in the same manner that it regulates private sector banks, which it cannot do at the moment because the Banking Regulation Act does not give the RBI full powers to do so.
Okay, interesting, Ritu. Thanks very much for those details. Of course, when it comes to appointments, there is a Bank Board Bureau, that mechanism that was established. So, of course, RBI has its own interesting viewpoint on the matter. Right now, it's time to talk commodities. Prathamesh Malia of Angel Commodities is joining in. Prathamesh, what are the top bets you're working with today?
Good afternoon. In the commodity space, I think the much-watched meeting between the U.S. President and the North Korean President has somewhat set the tone for commodity space. But then, if you're really talking about today's move, there is nothing that's happened as far as price move is concerned. But if you're looking for a trade in the commodity space, I think we would be a buyer in precious metals. I think the 30,400 are the target price for gold. If you're looking to buy gold, the entry point would be around 31,100. The stop would be around 30,950. So that is as far as gold is concerned. While we will also be a buyer in silver, I think 41,000 is what we are looking at as far as silver goes, and the entry point would be around 40,550. It's trading at around 40,600, and the stop would be around 40,200. So that's on the precious metal space. But as far as crude goes, I think a little bit of uncertainty and volatility would possibly come in this particular counter, take into consideration that OPEC might really not make any effort to cap its oil output, and in that sense possibly you'll see a certain move on the upside as far as oil prices goes. I think a move of around $1 or $2 from here on is what we're looking at as far as oil prices are concerned. WTI 65.66 is what is trading at. I think a move of around $2 from here on is what we're looking at. On the MCX, I think 4,500 is our near-term targets as far as oil goes.
All right, Prathamesh, thanks very much for joining in with those details and those trading ideas. With that, it's a wrap on this edition of Closing Bell. Thanks very much for watching. Stay tuned after the bell coming up next.